aren't you glad for the freedom that we have in Christ Jesus? The Bible says that it's for freedom that Christ set us free. Free from sin, free from disease, free from tribulations. Come on, why don't you lift up your hands wherever you are? Lift up your voice and give thanks. Thank Jesus for the price that he paid to purchase our freedom. Jesus, we bless your name, oh God. There's no one else like you. If love endured the Asian cross, how precious is my Savior's blood. Of heaven wrapped in my shame, the image of love upon this frame. If having my heart was worth the pain, what joy could you see beyond?
Freedom, when I see that grave, I see Jesus from death to life. I will sing your praise. In the world,
come on, let's do it.
When I see that cross, I see freedom. When I see that grave, I see Jesus from death to life. chains are gone. My debt is paid. From death to life and grace. From the ashes of defeat, the resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me.
Says that the same power that raised Jesus from the grave is available to us today. So that resurrection power will get us out of any situation that we feel is holding us down. That's why we sing, by His Spirit, we will rise from the ashes of defeat. If you are feeling defeated today, Jesus said that God, our good Father, would send Holy Spirit, and Holy Spirit would be with us. He would help us, He would guide us, He would teach us, but also Holy Spirit would empower us to live a life that honors God. You don't have to feel like a defeated person. I know you may be feeling like that, but God's Spirit is available. And I want to take a moment and pray for you right now. Father, you promised in your word that those of us who are in Christ are more than conquerors. So I pray for everyone watching today, those who are listening today to this service, and they feel like they are in the ashes of defeat. Defeat in their finances, defeat in their families, in their relationships. Maybe they feel defeated at work. It could be that by the end of this year, they won't have a job and they feel like they are defeated. Today, I pray and declare that by your Spirit, may they rise out of the ashes of defeat. I pray that they will see your victory. I pray that they will have a testimony of God's goodness in their lives. So I give you honor. I give you praise. Because Lord, you promise that when we ask, we will receive. When we seek, we will find. And when we knock at heaven's door, you are a good Father. You will open the doors and we shall see miracles. We shall see your good works. We shall see you turn around situations for your glory in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, 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 amen. We are more than conquerors in Christ Jesus. And he helps us to conquer by his Spirit. That is such a special, special song. And even the first song, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Receive that freedom that comes from knowing Jesus. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Well, this is a great season. Honestly, it is such an amazing season here at Watoto as we give our miracle missions offering. Be so extravagantly generous and sacrificially give so we can advance God's kingdom. And many of you are already sharing your stories of what God is doing in your life. Please let us know, because we can never outgive God. And God's desire is that we live a blessed life. And we do that by putting his kingdom first. And that's the series we are in. Well, in a few weeks, it's actually going to be Christmas. And so we are winding down this series, and we look forward to a brand new series as well as we prepare for Christmas time, a lovely time here at Watoto. So we have two more messages on the series, The Blessed Life. And today, Pastor Andrew Chimuli from Watoto Church, the western part of Kampala, Chengera, is coming to preach another powerful message as we carry on the series, The Blessed Life.
Thank you, Pastor Julius, for that introduction. So excited to be here to share with you the Word of God. I know you have been blessed by the worship, and I'm so proud of you. We're in such a season that is so amazing, a season of generosity, returning our miracle missions offering. So I'm so, so glad that you would choose to join us today. Now let's dive into the Word of God. Today, we are continuing with our series, Living a Blessed Life. And I'm going to be looking at breaking the spirit of Mammon. So if you have your Bibles, please turn to Luke 16, verse 9 to 13. This is what Jesus says. And I say to you, make friends for yourselves by unrighteous Mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you into an everlasting home. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to you trust that true riches? And if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? Now, verse 13 is the key one. No servant can serve two masters. For either he will hate one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. So the other text we'll also turn to is 1 Timothy 6:6. This is what it says up to verse 11. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we will take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothes, we will be content with that. People who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money, not money, for the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Many people eager for money have wandered from the faith and have pierced themselves with many griefs. Father, bless your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. You see, when we start speaking about the topic called money and living a blessed life, this topic brings along such attack from the enemy. Because money is a spiritual topic. There is a spiritual warfare going on. The enemy will not give ground without a fight. And so every time we're speaking about money, there's a spiritual warfare because money matters are spiritual matters. And so we need to be very careful. We need to be alert. We need to be prayerful lest the enemy takes ground. And you know what? God wants us to live a blessed life. And so if we get our money in check, when we align it with God, we will see success in our lives. You see, someone said, Randy Alcorn said, what we do with our money loudly affirms which kingdom we belong to. Whenever we give our resources to Father God's kingdom, we cast a vote for Christ or against Christ. And that is for certain. When we use our money well, we cast a vote for heaven and against hell. And so today we want to understand this topic called the spirit of mammon so that we can cast our vote for heaven. So I'm going to look at three questions and I'll be answering them for you. Question number one, what is mammon? I've just read a text in Luke 16 that says, no servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. It is so amazing that this is the only text that Jesus says, you cannot serve God and mammon. So it begs the question, what is mammon? You see, mammon is an Aramaic word that means riches. It comes from the Syrian gods of riches. Now, the Syrian gods of riches get their grounding from Babylon. Now, Babylon simply means sown in confusion. Now, that Babylon, in order for you to understand it, you go back to Genesis 11, where we have the Tower of Babel. Now, we all know what happened at the Tower of Babel. Man had a prideful, arrogant spirit that said, I don't need God. In fact, I'll go where God is. That prideful, arrogant spirit that says, I don't need God. So mammon is a prideful spirit that says, we do not need God. We want to replace God. All we need is money. So mammon is that prideful, arrogant spirit that tries to replace God. And it's all over the world. We see it today. People say, I either need God or money. When I have money, all is sorted. And that is not true. So mammon is a prideful, arrogant spirit that rests on money. It is a spirit that tries to replace God. You see, money, all money has spirit. It either has the spirit of God or the spirit of Satan, the spirit of mammon. When money is submitted to God, it has the spirit of God. When money is submitted to the world, it's not submitted to God, it has a mammon spirit. And that's why God tells us, Jesus says, you cannot serve God and mammon. Why? Because mammon wants to rule over you. Mammon wants servants. Mammon promises you everything and offers you nothing. Mammon tells you that all you need is money, which is not true. It promises you things that only God can give you. It will promise you security. It will promise you significance. It will promise you power. It promises you healing, joy. You would be happier if you had more money. But we all know that is not true. The only one who can give us true satisfaction, the only one who can give us identity, joy, happiness, is Jesus. And so all we need is Jesus. Jesus is the only one who can solve our problem. And friends, I believe that Mammon is the spirit of Antichrist. Because Revelation 13, verse 16 to 17 says it. It says, he, the Antichrist, has forced everyone, small, great, rich, poor, free, slave, to receive a mark on his right hand or on his forehead, so that no one could buy or sell unless he had the mark, which is the name of the beast, the number of his name. So we can see that the Antichrist is all about buying and selling, which is the spirit of Mammon. You see, when we speak about spirit, I want to bring to your attention that spirits speak. God's spirit speaks, but also the spirit of Mammon speaks. Now, many of you may be saying, Pastor, that is not true. Let me just tease it to you. When it's time to give, when it's time to give an offering, there are two voices you'll hear. You'll hear the voice of God, but also you'll hear the voice of Mammon. One voice says, give generously. The other voice says, why are you giving? Let me tease to you some of the voices that we hear. Mammon says, you cannot give 10% of your income. How will you survive the rest of the month? But the Spirit of God says, I will supply all your needs according to my riches. Mammon says, you do not need to tithe on the gross. Just do the net. That's very common. But God says, give a tithe of all your increase. After all, it is me who has given you the increase. Mammon says, you don't need to work or get a job. Just pray and fast. God will give you everything. But listen to what the Spirit of God says. God says that I will bless the works of your hands. Mammon says, you know what? You don't need to start tithing now. You earn very little. Until you start earning enough money, then you'll begin to be generous. But listen, God says, be faithful with the little, and I will entrust you with the much. You see, Jesus has never told anyone that the answer to our problem is more money. In fact, the theme scripture throughout this year for Watoto Church is Matthew 6:33. It says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the things shall be added unto you. So Jesus' way of solving problems is not seeking after money. It is going after his heart. It's going after Jesus. When we pursue Jesus, all the rest will be added unto us. So what is Mammon? Mammon is that arrogant, prideful spirit that tries to replace God and says you don't need to obey God's way in handling money. So the second one, how do we serve money? How do we serve money? Number one, we serve money when money becomes a key motivation to your life. When what drives you in life is all about money. When you realize that your key motivation to life is money, just know you're serving money. And we see this story in the Bible, Judas Iscariot. This is what it says in Matthew 26, verse 14 to 16. When one of the 12, the one called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and asked, what are you willing to give me if I hand him, Jesus, to you? So they counted out for him 20 silver coins. From then on, Judas watched an opportunity to hand him over. You see, Judas was motivated by money. When you find your life is only motivated by money, you are driven by money, just know you're serving money. And the end of Judas's life, we know he committed suicide. It's so unfortunate that he had to commit suicide. Did you know he's the only person recorded in the Bible, in the New Testament, who committed suicide? Listen to me. You see, money promises temporary satisfaction, but gives you permanent consequences. Money promises temporary satisfaction, but gives you permanent consequences. Number two, when money becomes the key determinant of the decisions you make. When money becomes the key determinant of the decisions you make, I have a question for you. When making decision, what comes first? Is it God or money? Do you always ask yourself, how much do I have in my bank account? Or do you ask yourself, God, what is it that you want me to do? God, what are you saying to me? When you find yourself in the position that every decision you make is about money, you know that you are swaying under the spirit of Mammon. You see, one of the greatest tragedy in life is the story that is found in Matthew 19. The rich young ruler. This man, Jesus tells him, go and sell off everything you have and you follow me. He chose a wrong decision. He chose to follow his wealth instead of eternal life with Jesus. I wonder, are you such a person that for you, all the decisions you make, it's about money? If that is you, my friends, you're following the spirit of Mammon. The third area that I know many people serve money is when we love money so much that we want more and more of it, but find it hard to let go of it. The scripture we read in 1 Timothy 6 says this, verse 9. People who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. Verse 10. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Do you realize it says for the love of money? Not money, for the love of money. And therein is a spirit of greed. When you want more and more and you don't want to give it away, you become greedy. And the Bible tells us greed is idolatry. You start worshiping money. Now you may be thinking, but I don't do that, Pastor. Let me give you some examples. Some of us, the spirit of greed has taken us to a place of getting money quickly in a manner that is not good. We have sports betting. We have slot machines. We have schemes that tell you if you invest in $5, you are able to get $1,000. That is not true. That is not true. That is being driven by greed. That is being driven with a love of money. So the fourth one is this. When our identity and security and satisfaction comes from money. You see, the world tells us that you are worth the things you have. You hear people say, what's your worth? What's your net worth? They're looking at property. The more property you have, the more cars you have, the more wives you have, the more things you have, the more husbands you have. Everything is more, more. And that is a spirit of materialism. And materialism is a spirit of Mammon. Society says, how much do you have? If you have a lot, then you're significant. Then that's your identity. That is not true. I have a friend of mine. He's my brother. He's called Mose. He always tells me, it doesn't matter whether you have 100 cars, 20 cars, or 3 cars. You can only drive one. Only one. You can't have one leg in one and another one. No, you can only drive one. It doesn't matter whether you have 10 houses. You can only sleep in one and only one bed. But you see, we have seen the spirit of materialism as a result of making money our identity destroy our communities. There's a king in the Old Testament who wrote a great scripture, quite long but beautiful scripture, Solomon. This is what he says. Ecclesiastes 2, 1 to 12 says, I say to myself, come on, let's try pleasure. Let's look for good things in life. But I found that this too was meaningless. So I said, laughter is silly. What good does it do to seek pleasure? After much thought, I decided to cheer myself with wine. And while still seeking wisdom, I clutched at foolishness. In this way, I tried to experience the only happiness most people find during their brief life in this world. I also tried to find meaning by building huge houses for myself, by planting beautiful vineyards. I made gardens, parks, filled them with all kinds of fruit trees. I built reservoirs to collect the water to irrigate my flourishing groves. I bought slaves, both men and women, and others were born in my household. I also owned large herds and flocks, more than any of the kings who had lived in Jerusalem before me. I collected great sums of silver and gold, the treasures of many kings and provinces. I hired wonderful singers, both men and women. I had many beautiful concubines. I had everything a man would desire. So I became greater than all who had lived in Jerusalem before me. And my wisdom never failed me. Everything I wanted, I would take. I denied myself no pleasure. I even found great pleasure in hard work, a reward for all my labors. But as I looked at everything I worked for so hard to accomplish, it was all meaningless, like chasing wind. There was nothing really worth anything. Wow. It was all meaningless. Materialism is one way we serve. When we serve mammon, when we make it the center of our lives. And one of the richest men says it's all nothing. So the question is, how do we break this kind of spirit? Three quick things. Number one, obedience to returning the tithe. The scripture says when we return the tithe, Malachi 3, 10 to 11, bring all the tithe into the house, storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now on this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you much blessing, that there will not be room enough for you to receive it. And this is the promise he gives you. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, so that he will not destroy the fruit of your land, nor shall the vine fall to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. When we submit our money to Jesus, he rebukes the spirit of mammon. So my friend, return the Lord's tithe. That's when you submit your money. Number two, if you want to break the spirit of mammon, we have what we call financial stewardship. The scripture we read in Luke 16 says this, verse 10, he who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. You see, God blesses stewardship. Live below your budget. Do not enter into debt. Do not try to please people. Live within your means. Use budgets to deal with your financial appetite. Be content with what you have. So what, number one, how we break it, we return. We are obedient to returning the tithe. Number two, financial stewardship. Be prudent with your finances. Number three, be generous. This is what the Bible says. I love this scripture. Proverbs 11, 24 says this. The world of the generous gets larger and larger. The world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller. If you want to break the shackles of the spirit of mammon, that arrogant, prideful spirit, I'm inviting you to a place of being generous. Live in the world of the generous, because it gets larger and larger. Do not allow the spirit of mammon to take away the joy of generosity. I gotta tell you, if you live your life when you return the Lord's tithe, when you have financial stewardship, and then when you are generous, the spirit of mammon will be off your life. So as I conclude, I want to remind you about the three questions that we've just answered. Mammon is a prideful spirit, an arrogant spirit that tries to replace God, that says you don't need to obey God. Then we looked at how do we serve money. We serve money when we make all our decisions depend on money, when the key motivation for our life is all about money, when we love a lot of money, we want it, and yet we are not willing to give it away, but also when our identity, our significance is found on money. Lastly, how do we break from the spirit of mammon? We've said all you need to do is submit your money to Jesus by returning the Lord's tithe. Be obedient. Have financial stewardship. God honors that and blesses that. And lastly, be generous. Today I want to read you a scripture. I conclude. Jesus wrote and says in Matthew 16, verse 26, 27, for what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? The spirit of mammon wants you to serve it. The spirit of mammon wants to hold you captive. The spirit of mammon wants to take your spirit, wants to take your soul. The spirit of mammon wants you to serve it. But today you have an opportunity to serve Jesus. Because what does it cost for you to lose your soul and gain the entire world? So my friend, today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of surrender. If you are there and you don't know Jesus, maybe you've been serving money, living for money. Today I want you to make a commitment to live for Jesus. Jesus is the only way. Jesus is the only life. Jesus is all you need. When you have Jesus, you have everything. You don't need to be under the shackles of Mammon. So if you're the one, I want you to type in that section on social media that I'm receiving Jesus today. I want you to call on that phone number that is on that screen, say, today I'm releasing my life to Jesus. Because Jesus wants you and wants your heart. He's not after your money, he's after your heart. In fact, it's not your money, it's his. Everything we have belongs to him. So let me pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for my sisters and my brothers that are receiving you today for their very first time. Lord, would you today come in their heart, make them a new creation, and may they walk from today onwards in obedience. In Jesus' name, amen. But I also want to pray for you. Maybe you are a Christian, but you've been struggling with the spirit of Mammon. I want to pray that today you will walk in obedience. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for your people that have struggled with the spirit of Mammon, where they have worshipped money, they have made money the focus of their life, they have made that arrogant, prideful spirit part of their lives. Today I pray that you release a grace that will allow them to walk in generosity, to walk in financial stewardship, but also to return the Lord's tithe, to submit their money to you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. I hope you have enjoyed the word of God. I turn back the service to Pastor Julius.
What a great message, Pastor Andrew. Thank you so much for enlightening us on the very fact that we can serve God or serve money. And those who put God's kingdom first put God above money. They don't allow money to rule their lives. Thank you for teaching us today. And it's a joy to serve with you. Those of you who have said yes to Jesus, welcome to the family of God. Would love to walk with you on the most exciting journey, and that's a journey following Jesus. Congratulations to you. Now we've come to that time where we get to give, like Jesus said, and it was quoted in Acts, it's more blessed to give than to receive. By the way, I want to share with you another update on our annual Miracle Missions offering. Last week, Pastors Gary and Marilyn gave us where we were at on just the first weekend, and we gave together $135,000. Well, this weekend, you have continued to give the miracle offering, and we are at just close to $305,000. That's over a billion shillings here in Uganda. Thank you so much, friends. And we're going to continue receiving the miracle offering until we hit our goal, because our desire is to advance the kingdom of God. And there are unique giving instructions for our miracle missions offering, because we want to track it and make sure each penny is used on a missional purpose and to bless others. So thank you very, very much. But now we got to give our tithes and our offerings. And the giving instructions are going to come up on the screen. And I just want to remind you, it's more blessed to give than to receive. God bless you as you give.
You can give using mobile money, direct bank transfer, or any banking agent within your community. But also, if you live close to any of our celebration points, you can simply walk over and slip your cash offering into one of the gift boxes. Now, for those using mobile money, let me walk you through the steps you would take. For MTN, dial *165*#, and the merchant code is 148775. That is 148775. And for Airtel, you dial *185*#, #9#. And the business number is 700,000. That is 7 followed by 5 zeros. For more giving options, check out our website, watotochurch.com/give. But you can also use your phone to scan the QR code, which will take you straight to the different giving options. And for your Watoto Child sponsorship, dial *165*#. Then enter the merchant code WCCM in capital letters. The merchant code is WCCM in capital letters. Now, as a reference, type the sponsor's full name only, fill in the amount to be paid, and finally, fill in your MTN mobile money PIN. Thank you for your generosity.
Fellow citizens and residents of Uganda, greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. As we continue to deal with the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic, we are now faced with a very challenging political season in our country. But despite the circumstances, I want to encourage you to know that God Almighty still has a great plan for Uganda. In Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, it says, God alone knows the plans that He has for us, and their plans to prosper us and not to harm us, plans to give us a hope and the future. You see, for us to walk in the promises of God, we all must take responsibility. We each have a part to play in building the Uganda that we hope for. To our police and armed forces, let me start by celebrating you for the work that you do to ensure that we as citizens live in a protected and a secure country. Thank you very much. We do, however, recognize that in times like these, the pressure of the moment is really tough and it's not easy to navigate. So every day, as you go to perform your duties in this volatile season, I implore you to apply the words of Jesus, the golden rule, do to others as you'd have them do to you. Now, fellow citizens, brothers and sisters, and those who reside in Uganda, regardless of our political affiliation, regardless of our tribe or status, we too have a serious responsibility in building our country, Uganda. Whatever we do as citizens matters, my friends. But just like the Bible says, we must not let our anger cause us to sin. Acting out of revenge will never solve any of the problems that we face as a nation. So here's what we need to do. Let's practice honor and respect for each other, but also let's practice self-control when offended. For those of us who are in authority, whether political leadership or otherwise, or for those who are vying for leadership positions at such a time as this, it's really an honor for us to be trusted as leaders. We have many people who are following us, watching us, listening to us. So we need to use our voice wisely. We need to do it the Bible way. Speak the truth in love. Please remember, our voice is important. Let's use it to speak life and hope to our people, to the Christians. This is a unique moment in our country, and we have a unique responsibility at such a time as this. There's so much fear and worry, so much anxiety, frustration, anger. But the Bible says in Philippians chapter 4 that let's not be anxious about anything, but in everything we need to pray and make our requests known to God, and the peace of God that goes beyond human understanding will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. There's power, my friends, when we pray. God has not forgotten us. God loves you. God loves Uganda, and God still has great plans for our country, Uganda, that remains the pearl of Africa. God bless you.
But Jesus,
You're the promise that won't let go, Jesus. There's no other name.
For joining us today. If you would like to connect with someone or for prayer and counseling, please call any of the numbers you see on your screen right now or write to connect@watotochurch.com.
And to catch up on our previous sermons or for more information about church life, visit our website, watotochurch.com.
Remember to follow us on all our social media platforms and tune in to 104.1 Power FM for uplifting programs for you and your family. You can also do life together with people in your community through our small groups. How do we do that, Pascal?
Yes, we do that in our small groups called cell. And this experience has just gotten better because you can come together with your cell in your homes and enjoy this worship experience. So if you're not in cell, you're missing out on a lot. So to join a cell, write to cell@watotochurch.com.
You can still take part in our Miracle Missions offering. For those of you who already gave, thank you for your generosity. And if you'd still love to give, you are most welcome to. Feel free to drop your offering at any of our celebration points or visit our website, watotochurch.com/give, for more electronic giving options. God bless you and have a great week.